गाइस, वेलकम बैक टू फूड टेक जर्नी। सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस क्लासिफिकेशन एंड स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ प्रोटीन्स इन फूड। विदाउट वेस्टिंग टाइम लेट्स स्टार्ट। टू अंडरस्टैंड प्रोटीन, लेट्स फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट आर अमीनो एसिड, एज दीज आर द बिल्डिंग ब्लॉक्स ऑफ प्रोटीन्स। अमीनो एसिड्स आर प्रोटीन्स कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट्स व्हिच कंटेन बोथ बेसिक अमीनो ग्रुप and an acidic carboxyl group attached to a carbon atom. Some also contains third group R, which is a side chain. Different types of amino acids are negatively charged R groups, non-polar R groups, polar uncharged R groups, and positively charged R groups. Negatively charged R groups are hydrophilic in nature, while non-polar R groups are hydrophobic in nature. These are the examples of all the four types of amino acids. Now let's go to proteins. So proteins are made up of amino acids, as these are the building blocks. These are principal components of living cells. These also functions as enzymes in biocatalysts, as enzymes in hormones, in antibodies, and as transport agents as well. Proteins are made by peptide bond. So what is peptide bond? When amino group of one amino acid reacts with carboxyl group of another, a peptide bond is formed, as you can see here, right? So when 2 to 10 amino acids combines, then oligopeptide is formed. When more than 10 amino acids join, then polypeptide is formed. And when hundreds of amino acids join, then protein is formed. About peptides, these forms the linear peptide chains, right? So these are divided into two parts based on the terminal residue. First one is N-terminal, another is C-terminal. N-terminal is for free amino group, while the C-terminal is for carboxyl group. Understood? There's one more thing about peptides, that when we have to do treatment of peptide or protein with cuprous ion in alkaline solution, it yields a purple color. This is used in estimation of peptides also. Next we have classification of protein. Proteins are classified on the basis of composition in three parts. First is derived protein, second conjugated protein, and third one is simple protein. Derived protein are proteins, metaproteins, peptones, and peptides. Conjugated proteins, as these yields amino acid and prosthetic groups like carbohydrate, lipids, nucleic acid, and phosphates. These are the conjugated proteins. While simple protein, these yields only amino acids, and that also on hydrolytic degradation. These are albumin, globulin, glutelins, prolamines, histones, and proteomines respectively. When protein combines with lipids, then lipoproteins is formed, like triglycerides, phospholipids, cholesterol. These are found in cells and bloodstream. These also serves as transporters of lipids in food. Lipoproteins are SGLP, LDLP, VLDLP. The high density lipoprotein, low density lipoprotein, and very low density lipoprotein. Got it? Next we have glycoproteins. These are the prosthetic groups, as this contains hexosamine, galactose, mannose, fucose, and sialic acid. Example can be ovomucoid, which is present in egg white. Glycoproteins are found in mucus secretion of mammals, and these also functions as lubricating agents. Then we have metalloproteins. These are complexes of proteins and heavy metals. For example, hemoglobin and myoglobin. These are also present in egg as cone albumin. Then we have nucleoproteins. These are complexes of proteins and nucleic acids. These are present in nucleoprotamines and these are also present in DNA and RNA in little quantity. Then we have phosphoproteins. These are proteins conjugated with inorganic phosphate. For example, milk. It contains protein casein and enzyme pepsin. Next we have structure of proteins. So on the basis of structure, proteins are divided into four types. First is primary, then secondary, then tertiary and quaternary. As you can see in the diagram as well. So what is primary? These consist of amino acids and polypeptide chains. These consist of amino acids which are sequenced along the polypeptide chains, right? And these are joined by peptide bonds. For example is hemoglobin. Then we have secondary structures. These are extended peptide chain which are not stable. So these folds into itself. That is, you can imagine it like these are closely bounded or arranged in 3D manner. As you can also see in the figure, when these polypeptide chains runs in similar direction. Then these are called as parallel pleated sheets, and when they run in opposite direction, then anti-parallel. These are found in silk and insect fibers. You can also see the example. This one is alpha helices, and these are beta sheets, right? Then tertiary. These tertiary are, these involves the folding of regular units of secondary structure, as well as structuring of areas of the peptide chains. These are formed by the folding of the secondary structures. When alpha helices and beta sheets folds and forms a structure, a more messy structure, then it is called as tertiary. Example can be insulin, right? These are hydrophobic residues actually. Then we have quaternary. These are formed by two or more polypeptide chains of tertiary and secondary as well. So these structures are formed when individual polypeptide chains interact to form a native protein molecule. So as you know that protein molecule is formed when hundreds of amino acids joins together. So in order to form a native protein molecule, quaternary structure is formed. Example of quaternary structure can be keratin. Next we will discuss properties of proteins. These are hydrophilic R groups on the exterior part of the molecule and hydrophobic on the interior part. This also behaves as electrolytes due to some physical and chemical proteins. As for this, if proteins contains high content of acidic group like aspartic and glutamic, its isoelectric point is low. And if basic amino acids like arginine and lysine, then protein has increased isoelectric point. So applications of behaving as electrolytes can be electrophoresis or ion exchange chromatography, etc. Next, these can be hydrolyzed with acids, alkali or enzymes. And complete hydrolysis can take place with HCl for 8 to 10 hours at 120 degrees Celsius. This can happen, actually this is an ideal condition. When we will use 6 amp HCl for 8 to 10 hours. 8 to 10 hours at 120 degrees Celsius. then destruction of tryptophan takes place, due to which complete hydrolysis takes place. Then we have denaturation. You all have heard of the term denaturation as well. It is loss of native conformation, which brings changes in specific properties and identity of proteins. And what happens due to temperature or high pressure or UV radiation or decline or increment in pH or addition of synthetic detergents. These are the factors causing denaturation. So the it is the alteration of DNA. You can say for denaturation that it is the alteration of DNA. Then we have putrefaction. Putrefaction involves decarboxylation, or you can say deamination, means of flavor or of texture by the involvement of microbial proteases. Microbial proteases causes of flavor or texture properties. Then we have protein gels formation. We will also discuss about protein gels in the next slide as well. Now let's understand what are protein gels. Here we have protein gels. When the proteins absorbs water to 10 times more than hydrated proteins, then protein gels are formed. As you can see here that these have ability to absorb water. They are capable of immobilizing water 10 times equal to hydrated protein. Examples can be gelatin and casein. If attractive forces on proteins are increased, like changing in pH value closer to isoelectric point, then the gel tends to shrink. So what happens is, this is about protein gels. It's a special point about protein gels, that if attractive forces on proteins are increased, that is changing pH value closer to isoelectric point, then the gel tends to shrink, which means the water is expelled. This process is called as synergies. Let me write it down for you. The process is called as synergies. Expelled water, or you can say immobilizing the water out of the cell. Synergies. Okay. You can explicit it from the term that food proteins are the proteins present in animals or plants. First is plant protein, another are animal protein. So the protein which are present in plant are called plant protein, and the proteins which are present in animal are called animal protein. Some examples of plant proteins are lysine and tryptophan are present in potato. Prolamines, lyodins and luteolins are present in endosperm. Globulins, albumins are present in germ. Prolamine, luteolins in rice. Lysine, methionine in oilseed and nut. And methionine in pulses. And for animal proteins, myoglobin is present in red meat. Casein and whey in milk. Dipoproteins in egg yolk. And fish contains various enzymes. These are some examples of food proteins. Next, we will discuss about the nutritional importance of protein. So, it plays a functional role as it helps in formation of gels, emulsion, solution, which contribute to color and flavor of proteins and many other food products. It is nutritive as it supplies nitrogen and amino acids for synthesis of body proteins and other nitrogen containing substances. It also provides energy as it is as at optimum nutritional level. At optimum nutrition level, when it is present about 10-14% of total energy in the diet by proteins, then 1 gram of protein will yield 4.1 kcal of energy. Understood? 1 gram of protein will yield 4.1 kcal of energy, as you can see. Okay? This happens at only optimum nutritional level. Then we have some essential amino acids which can't be synthesized by man. As you know that there are 20 amino acids required by the body and 9 of them can't be synthesized by man. So these are histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, threonine, tryptophan and valine. Now we have discussed about proteins. We also have some important things related to proteins. So we will discuss about biochemical changes in post-mortem and tenderization of muscles in this video only. So what do you understand about biochemical changes and tenderization of muscles? You have heard of the term meat, right? What do you get from the meat? Meat, these are flesh, edible parts of animals like cattle, sheep and swine which are used for food. Not only muscles and fat but also tendons and ligaments of these animals. There are basically 6 types of meat. First one is pork. Let me write it down for you. First one is pork. Then we have beef. Then we have chicken. Then we have duck. Then we have turkey. And lamb and mutton are also the types of meat. Lamb and mutton. Okay? So, let's discuss the changes, the post-mortem changes, or you can see the biochemical changes which takes place after the slaughtering of animals. So, slaughter of food animal is followed by a series of physical and chemical changes over a period of time, which can be hours or days, resulting in conversion of muscle to meat. Muscle is converted into meat, right? Muscle to meat. So, first is, this happens due to exsanguination, which is also called as bleeding. You can refer to bleeding. Due to bleeding, there is loss of oxygen supply to muscle. So, the oxygen which is stored in myoglobin, as myoglobin is present in blood, so the oxygen which is present in myoglobin gets depleted. So, there is inhibition of aerobic pathway through citric acid cycle as well as cytochrome system. So, and of creatine phosphate, the creatine phosphate is also stored, which is used for rephosphorylation. What is rephosphorylation? When CP, let me write it down. When creatine phosphate, that is CP, reacts with ADP, combines with ADP, then there is formation of ATP and creatine. Then ATP plus creatine is formed. Right? ATP plus creatine is formed. So, what happened due to bleeding or exsanguination? It gets exhausted soon after the death of the animal. Energy and about the breakdown of glycogen to lactic acid, what happens? The energy metabolism shifts to anaerobic pathway due to loss of oxygen, which results in breakdown of glycogen to lactic acid. And this process continues and it ends when all the glycogen also gets exhausted. And then the biochemical changes start taking place one by one. These all processes takes place by a series of changes. Let's discuss them one by one. So these are the important changes taking place during postmortem. Postmortem means biochemical changes which are happening after the death of animal. First is loss of homeostasis. You can understand it like this: when a system for balanced internal environment helps the body to cope up with the stresses of oxygen deficiency. As you know, the oxygen is lost, so this helps the body to cope up with the stresses of oxygen deficiency and extreme variations in temperature, energy supply and pH, etc. These all gets lost, right? So within 4 to 6 minutes of bleeding, in absence of blood supply, this is controlled, this all process is controlled by nervous system within 4 to 6 minutes of bleeding. So in absence of blood supply, there's loss of body heat, so which is directly proportional to declination of temperature. So basically what is happening here is in order to cope up with the body, these oxygen deficiency and various energy supply, nervous system is coordinating this whole internal system. And about most postmortem glycolysis and pH decline, first we will discuss postmortem glycolysis. In absence of oxygen, anaerobic glycolysis leads to formation of lactic acid from glycogen reserves. Let me show you. What happens is, this is glycogen. In anaerobic conditions, these are the anaerobic conditions represented by anaerob. Lactic acid plus ATP is formed. Actually, not one, two ATP are formed. This is the chemical reaction taking place. Okay? So in first few hours, this gradual I am telling about pH decline. We have discussed the postmortem glycolysis here. Then about pH decline, the gradual decline continues in the first few hours from approx 7 pH in living muscle, and then this after 15 to 20 hours, the pH goes ranging from around 5 to 6 pH. It could be 5.5, 5.7, anything. And then the rate of pH decline is enhanced at high environmental temperature. And sharp decline takes place. And it can also cause the denaturation of proteins as well. Actually, pH decline... In pH decline, muscles depict pale, soft and exudative condition, which is called as PSE condition also. So what happens, the body or the muscle of the animal depicts a pale color and it becomes soft and exudative. And if there's high pH, This is the low pH condition, and in high pH condition, DFD conditions takes place. What is D? D means dark, F means firm, and D means dry. DFD conditions takes place. It is seen in meat. And there's my normal conditions where pH ranges around that 5.5 to 5.7. Then we have rigor mortis. What is rigor mortis? It is the stiffening of muscles after death. It is an important postmortem change for conversion of muscle to meat. What happens here is that the actomyosin bond breaks and brings muscle to a relaxed state. Actomyosin bond can be break by particular concentration of ATP complex with magnesium ion. It is to break the bond. So during this period of exsanguination, the actomyosin formation proceeds very slowly at first, and the muscle is relatively extensible and elastic in nature. This period is called as delay phase of rigor mortis. Then, when actomyosin formation picks up and muscle begins to lose extensibility, this phase is called as fast phase. You can say fast phase or onset phase also, because the process becomes very fast, or onset phase. Next, we have another property is loss of protection from invading microorganisms. So what happens during postmortem? Body defense mechanism stops operating, right? So if something will die, then definitely body defense mechanism will stop operating and membrane properties will get altered. So during conversion of meat or muscle, it is susceptible to microorganisms, right? So except for low pH, most of the other, as on low pH, it is acidic in nature. So most of the other postmortem changes favor bacterial growth except for low pH. So precautions should be taken, right? Next, we have degradation due to proteolytic enzymes. The enzyme which takes place is cathepsins can be written as cathepsin enzyme, which remain inactive in living muscle tissue, activates as pH of muscle declines. This is cathepsins. So this enzymes, so the pH of muscle declines, right, which cause degradation of muscle protein structure. So cathepsin enzymes causes degradation of muscle protein structure. It can also cause tenderization of meat during the aging period. Then we have loss of structural integrity. The aging comes under loss of structural integrity only. It is loss of structure integrity involves the postmortem alterations of membrane properties, which initiates degradation of muscle proteins. What happens here is there is rapid decline in muscle pH, which also causes denaturation of connective tissues and proteins as well. What is aging? Aging means when we hold the carcasses just above the freezing point to prevent spoilage, and this process is accompanied by an enhancement in meat. In aging period, there is enhancement in flavor and texture of meat. Like enhancement flavor mainly attribute to inosine monophosphate, which happens by the breakdown of ATP and breakdown of protein, fat, results in ammonia, hydrogen sulfide, and acetone, diacetyl also, which enhances meat's flavor and texture. Basically, aging period is in every food production process because it enhances the flavor of the food. Then next, we have changes in temperature. So temperature of animal increases from 37 degrees Celsius to 39 degrees Celsius. That's why animal cools slowly during the refrigeration as a result of continuous production of heat. This phenomena is known as animal heat. What does the temperature change predict? That when the meat is processed through high temperature, definitely it is processed through high temperature, right? So due to this, the refrigeration takes place more rapidly. So this phenomena is known as animal heat. So removal of animal heat by chilling or refrigeration is essential to ensure the long shelf life of animals. Next, we are going to summarize, as it is too much to remember. Let me summarize it for you with the help of this flowchart. So what happens is, firstly, death of animal takes place, right? Death of animal takes place. Then what will happen? Fall in O2 supply, right? And stoppage of blood circulation, then fall in oxygen supply, then fall in oxidation and reduction potential, right? So what will happen? To understand it better, we will first discuss about respiration cases, because two processes takes place. First one is respiration, another is glycolysis. These two processes start. What happens in respiration cases? The conversion of glycogen to carbon dioxide stops. So due to which decrease in ATP and creatine phosphate level occurs. So onset of rigor mortis was when the actomyosin formation picks up. It starts more rapidly. The muscle begins to lose extensibility. That phase was called onset phase, right? So you can say that accumulation of various flavor also, because these all takes place after this. So onset of rigor mortis start. Another one is denaturation of proteins, which involves exudation of fluid and discoloration. Denaturation of proteins means alteration of DNA, which causes the exudation of fluids and discoloration also. Now let's come to glycolysis. In glycolysis, it happens under anaerobic conditions, right? So this presence of O2 and this one is absence of oxygen. So in glycolysis, lactic acid is formed from glycogen. Glycogen converts into lactic acid under anaerobic conditions, and this causes decline in pH. And the liberation and activation of cathepsins occurs in this, which causes protein degradation and bacterial growth also. After denaturation of proteins also, bacterial growth, the food is prone to bacterial growth. So preventions must be taken, as it could be very hazardous to consume. I hope you understand till here. If you have any doubt, you can post in the comment section. I will reply to that. Thank you.